Thank you very much, Phil. Can you all hear me up the back? I prefer to talk and walk and wave my arms around rather than hold a microphone, so I'll just shout. And I would particularly like to start by thanking the University of South Australia and the Knowledge Works program for inviting me here to talk about our work on citizen science and some of the work that we've been doing with the community around engaging and understanding urban animals. I'd also like to take a moment to point out that this young gentleman, Mr. Philip Reutemann, is the senior author on this work. Phil, whether he probably regrets it or not now, in 2007 stuck his head around my door just after I'd started because he'd heard me muttering that I needed someone to help out with a couple of odd jobs. So he said, well, can I help? So he started off working for us for nothing in 2007, and now we pay him a pittance. But he has taken and led this whole program that I'm going to talk about citizen science, developed the citizen science methodology, and applied it to some really interesting situations. Phil and I would also like to acknowledge that about 50, slightly over 50, people over the last 4 or 5 years have engaged in this project. And they include people like our students in master's courses, people who've worked on the computing behind the surveys, people who've published the books, people who've provided us information, our partners through Denner and the museum, and of course our partners in the wider media. So we're really grateful to this huge team of people who gave up a huge amount of our time for us to ask and answer questions around urban ecology and around citizen science. Phil and I would view ourselves as urban ecologists. And urban ecology is the study of the relationship between plants and animals and the natural components of the environment. And that includes the soils, the rocks, the weather, the climate, the wind, all these sorts of things. But in a urban community, you've got other interactions in there as well. You've got humans and what humans do and decide to do with animals and plants. You've got the continual introduction of new species, the disappearance of native species. You've got the continual construction of the built environment, the human environment, and that changes its nature. So you've got all of these things going on at once. And these can be very powerful evolutionary forces. And you get the change, you get a very rapid change in the relationship between plants and animals. And you would know that when you think about species that you might have seen 20 or 30 years ago that you don't see now, animals like woolly wagtails, for example. But suddenly there's lots of corellas around, or galahs, sulfur-crested cockatoos have appeared. And they've all been here because there've been these sudden changes for a whole variety of reasons. So studying this relationship between plants, animals, native environment, introduced animals, built environment, people, what people do, is a really interesting and fun thing to do. So we've embarked on a program of understanding urban ecology. And Adelaide's a great spot to do this because it is a biodiversity hotspot. In fact, the Adelaide-Mount Lofty Ranges region is one of 15 biodiversity hotspots in the country. It's the only one that's wholly within South Australia. The other one's right down the southeast that bunts into Victoria. And it contains some 30% of the state's plants, 60% of the state's birds, 20 to 30% of the state's reptiles, amphibians, fish and mammals, all within an area that's a tiny fraction of 1% of the area of the state. So it's a very biodiverse, rich area. It's also the source, if you like, of the vast majority of introductions of plants and animals over the last 170 odd years since we've been here. So it's a very important location to look at urban ecology. It's also a place that's undergoing a great deal of social change, driven largely by a large immigration that really started at around 2000. And it's now estimated that the population of Adelaide will hit 2 million, really, within the next couple of decades. This is a very rapid growth, and it's some 23 years ahead of the original target, where we wanted 2 million by 2050. So it's a community that's undergoing enormous change, an incredibly rapid rate. And the plan for Greater Adelaide, the 30-year plan, has recognised the second aspect of the Adelaide Mount Lofties, which is it's an island. It's a little green oasis, if you like, surrounded by desert. We can often think of the Adelaide-Mount Lofty Ranges region as what's called a bassian relict. A bassian environment is cool, temperate, high rainfall area with often dense eucalypts or open woodland, much more similar to southwestern Western Australia or Victoria than it is to the immediately adjacent areas, which are much more arid. And they're called Aerian, the Aerian type environments of sand dunes and mallee and so forth, and drier areas. So we've got this little island. And this little island is a biodiversity island with a high input of animals and this rapid growth rate. So the plan for Greater Adelaide has highlighted three things about this island: that there will be population and economic growth, that there is a need to protect this island because it's a primary food producer for the state and for the country, and that we need to protect environmental assets, biodiversity assets. So we've got all of these forces kind of happening at once within the region. And one of the things that most perturbed us, and I suspect perturbs most of you, is that with this change in community, there is a change in the way we live. And the way we live is impacting on how we interact with wildlife. The traditional sort of Adelaide household or house block looks something like this. It was a large block originally, really back before the Second World War. The house block was regarded as a quarter acre. And there's still a myth of having the quarter acre house or house block in Australia. By the Second World War, that had shrunk to a sixth of an acre. Now many house blocks are down to about 200 square metres. A traditional house occupied usually less than 50% of the block. We had a large backyard, front yard, large amounts of vegetation, and the house was comparatively small. We're moving away from this sort of style as the population has grown into trying to retain the Australian dream by making the house block smaller. The houses themselves are getting larger, and many houses now occupy 90% of the area of a house block. And most of the other bit is just the strip around the edges between one house and the next. You can see in this side, so I don't want to say where this suburb is, but that's Coromandel Parade down the road. There's the road here. So 50-year-old suburb, 10-year-old suburb. You can see that there's no backyards, no front yards, no greenery. There's sort of nothing there. This is one significant tree on this spot here. And so you can actually do studies of the environment on this side of the road compared to that. And this side is hotter in the summer, colder in the winter. It has no biodiversity because it's got no green. So there's nothing to provide food for birds, butterflies, lizards, those sorts of things, and nowhere to hide as well. There's no habitat there. The water runoff is greater because there's much more hard surface. So the stormwater management issues are much greater there. And of course, the energy consumption on that side of the road is much greater because it's hotter. So they've all got big air conditions and so forth. So there is this move as well, it's part of all this change in the ecology, towards living in this sort of a way. And the big issue with that is it takes people away from their connection with nature. We have been a fortunate community in living like this, in having lots of nature around us. Birds in the big trees, lizards in the grass, butterflies, a whole range of different animals. So we've been able to enjoy them and grow up with them. But you can't on this side of the fence. On top of that, there's been this strange kind of growing pitch that wildlife is bad for you. And this has been kind of fermented by people like Bear Grylls, who takes the environment as something to be beaten, conquered, stomped on, climbed over. It is the enemy, and you win by beating it. And there's been a lot in the literature, the popular literature, the press, books and so forth, about Australian animals being absolutely lethal. And if you do anything to encourage wildlife to your space, you will attract deadly animals hell-bent on destroying you and your children. And that all Australian animals live solely for the reason of ripping your face off and having you die in a horrible bleeding mess in the most brutal way possible. If you go swimming, well, the moment you go swimming, the white pointers will get you, and you know they will. The snakes, the spiders, they're all to be feared. But in fact, we live with these and have always lived with these incredibly well. And if you think about it, they actually help define who we are. If you get a visitor from overseas, get some ancient relative who's come there, who's never seen any animal, and you show them a redback spider, first thing they'll do is freak out and run screaming from the room going, how can we possibly spend any time with you if you're sharing with these things? But you've probably collected it. You found it, it's been in the under the dunny seat, as red bit spiders do, or it's out the back, and you notice it, you collect it, you throw away, and you don't think anything about it. And in fact, living with these animals is one of the things that makes us who we are. Now, we are Adelaideans, South Australians, Australians, because we know there are dangerous snakes in the hills, but we still go walking. We know that there are poisonous spiders in the shed, but we still go into the shed, and we know how to catch them, how to live with them. They are part of our sense of place, and they help define us. And it's a bit cool. It's a bit cool to tell, you know, the relative who's come from overseas, who's having a freak out because they've seen a huntsman, that you go, nothing! We get those all the time. That's one of the really cool things about being an Australian. So, in fact, we are losing that sense of place, that sense of identity, as we move into this feeling that animals are bad for you. And that leads us to create communities that are environmentally free, or are free of environment, if you like, are devoid of environment. This is Aldinga. This is a recent community that was sold. The houses were sold as being sustainable because it didn't have any lawn, so you didn't need to worry about watering it. And in fact, many communities now around the world, this is in Florida, this is another one in the US, are really communities completely devoid of environment. So we have effectively a no connection with nature, and it's called nature deficit disorder, and our communities are growing up in a very different way. You add to that a whole swag of other things, such as changing recreational practices, particularly with kids who spend more of their time killing Nazi zombies on the computer than they do climbing trees. You've got a change, and that change is really driven by the statement that we hear a lot from developers, which is people don't want backyards. So what we were trying to do as urban ecologists is look at how we could understand urban ecology, understand the processes that occur in cities around plants, animals and humans, and also have a mechanism whereby we can connect or reconnect people with nature and understand that relationship between people and wildlife, and be able to use that understanding, in fact, have the community tell us what they know so that we can help tell others what we should be doing around wildlife. And the way we did it was by using the citizen science methodology. Now, citizen science methodology is a way of connecting people and people with science, particularly by involving them in the scientific process. Now, there's a number of ways that you can describe the scientific process. The most traditional ones are really these two here, which is the first one's hypothesis testing. And actually, I've always been a hypothesis scientist. You ask a question that has a yes or a no answer, you go out and test it, and then depending on that answer, you move forward to the next question. So you could have a sick baby and a vaccine, you whack the vaccine into the baby, baby dies, vaccine doesn't work, baby lives, vaccine works, go off and collect Nobel Prize. Now, it's a simple question and answer. And a lot of the community are fairly frustrated by this sort of approach because it only answers little bits and it builds on bits in a sequential way. So usually the scientists say, oh well, we've made this discovery, but we'll be able to implement it in 5 years or 10 years when we've asked a whole lot of other questions. So the community can be quite frustrated about this form of hypothesis testing, deductive reasoning type of approach. The second approach is to collect a huge amount of data over an extended period, usually, through monitoring and evaluation, and then look for patterns in that data that can tell you about the situation that you're examining, and also perhaps help you predict what might happen in the future. And this inductive type reasoning and data collection is practiced with things like climate change. Meteorological data is classic in this, where we might have 100 years of rainfall data, and then we'll use that to try to predict whether we're entering a drying period or a climate change period or a rainfall period and so forth. And it's really hard to do that. You're looking for patterns in the past to predict for the future, and there's always going to be errors in that. It is impossible to always predict with incredible accuracy what will happen next. And the community, of course, don't enjoy that either. They want an answer from you scientists. What are we paying you for? You're just saying, well, there's a 50% possibility that it might be wetter and a 50% possibility that it might be drier. Well, that doesn't really help much. And only by collecting more data and you expand your data can you reduce the limits, the variation around the data, so your predictions become better. So that's been very frustrating for community, and often then we get a disengagement of community with the scientific process and a distrust of scientists as not really being any good at all, really. We can just say anything we want. And this was kind of highlighted by the New South Wales Minister for Health, who said, I'm sick of all of this research, just give me the answers. So the other thing about citizen science is that we can answer those questions about urban ecology and engagement by adopting this new framework. And citizen science is a framework whereby professional scientists will engage the community in a research project as researchers collecting data, participating in the project, and also participating or being involved in the outcomes of the research. So they see the analysis and they observe and the results and the conclusions that come from it, and be part of the implementation of that sort of research. So it's one where the community and scientists work together. And part of the process is an educational process. And that's what we were really looking for when we were talking about engaging the community with the natural environment. So it's a cooperative framework involving research and education. And it's taken off. It really started some 100 years ago, but there's all sorts of different citizen science projects being conducted around the world now, using a whole mass of different methodologies, and it involves all sorts of different participants, all sorts of different questions. The big thing about citizen science from a scientific viewpoint, from my biased viewpoint, is that we can collect huge amounts of data in very short periods of time. We can engage people. We found with the four surveys that we'll talk about, we wound up with some 2,000 responses for each of these surveys. So we could get information about the location of animals across the city and across the state all at one time. And there's no way I could gather that information with just myself and Phil and a couple of others going out there. And that's particularly important when we come to look at people's backyards. You can't get into their backyards. People don't like it if you do that. I had one really attractive young research assistant when we first started off on this project. She was 20 years old, tall, leggy, blonde, and she was collecting data about how birds use street trees in Unley Park. And one day she was doing it, it was just in the street trees, three police cars came screaming up and they bundled her in and took her down to the Adelaide police station. I had to come down and bail her out. And it turned out that one of the residents in this particular street in Unley Park had thought she was casing the joint for her boyfriend Guido, and the moment anyone left he'd arrive with a truck and offload all the goodies. So I had to bail her out and bring her back here and explain to our head of school then what exactly I was doing. But you see, you can't have access. So it enables you to collect lots of information. It enables you to get in places that are inaccessible, whether they be out there or in people's backyards. And you can collect all sorts of data. So you can collect data, GIS type data, where are animals, what are they doing. You can collect social data, how are people interacting with those animals. And you can collect standard sort of quantification data, what are people doing with those animals, what are those animals doing. In this case, this is some possum management structures. So you can collect as a scientist some really good information. And that's why this has taken off. It started off really with a lot of studies around birds. Because birds are easy to observe, and there were very strong amateur communities of ornithologists who observed birds, knew birds, and wanted to participate in these sorts of studies. So bird migration data started back in the 1880s. There's a Christmas bird count in England. The Cornell Lab does a whole swag of them. There's a really interesting citizen science project called Budburst, where people send in when their plants start blooming in their gardens in the United States. And by keeping that data over 10 years, they've seen what's happened to the change of seasons as determined by plants. WaterWatch is a citizen science where a lot of school kids have engaged in water sampling. Globe at Night is another one. There's all sorts of different projects appearing. And you can get incredibly valuable data that leads to great scientific sorts of publications. Here are a couple that we've put down here, Birds in Forested Landscapes, the Protea Atlas Project, which has led to scientific publications. My current favourite is a project that they did in Europe 2 years ago where they asked people to collect snails in their backyard, give exact locations, and they all sent in their snails to the central laboratory. I forgot where it was in Paris, I think. And they got snails from all over Europe, all the way through to Russia, England, Ireland, everywhere from this one species of snail. The scientists then counted the whorls and the swirls and the patterns on the snails and were able to track the evolution of these snails and the different snail patterns as they radiated out across Europe. And it got the cover of Nature, and it was a really cool project. But it again engaged citizenry in the process of science. So there's all sorts of great data that you can collect using this process. The trick is making sure that you bring the community on and you continually validate the data so that the data is strong and robust and trustworthy. And you can do this with a number of ways. You can train participants in how to sample water, in what to see in a bird, those sorts of things depending on the questions that you're asking. And you can provide large amounts of online information, which is what we have done in the past. And it's also very important that the scientists are involved in the whole process, that they can validate the data by looking to see. And in various projects, we've had scientists who look at the plants, if plants are being collected, or send in photos to see if there was the correct comet was observed and where it was on particular nights in that case, water sample measurements and so forth. And we've always collected photographs, particularly when we're doing spiders, so that we could see that people were identifying the correct spider. And of course you can tell what data is just beyond the limits of the community to participate in. And we bumped into a limit with this little guy here, which is a pygmy possum. One of our projects was to look at the distribution of the three types of possum in South Australia, the brush tail, the ring tail, and the pygmy possum, which is about the size of a mouse. Really cute little guy, but very rare and very difficult to see. And we wound up getting quite a number of interesting observations of pygmy possums in the parklands and in North Adelaide, which of course didn't turn out to be pygmy possums, they were mice. And we got one observation where one person saw a ringtail possum going along a power line followed by six pygmy possum. Of course, they were baby ringtails. But so you can actually, this was just too hard a task to ask people to identify. So you can check on the validity of the data, but it yields very strong types of information for us as scientists. From the community's viewpoint, by providing information, you embark on the education process. You give the information, the identification, why do it, what's the problem, so that people can do, in our case the surveys, can do the surveys about the animals, but in particular so they do it. Why is it important to look at possums? Why are magpies so important? What is it about spiders that are cool? Asking really good questions so people get engaged and they start spending time with animals that they wouldn't otherwise do. So we always were very cautious about our education process for the can and the do. Then exchange into feedback to build trust with community, to deliver outcomes, and in our case we deliver them through books, and then develop community understanding. And it is really important when we come back to that nature deficit disorder, that issue that the community may be growing up more distant from wildlife than we did. We need to get them to have the community have an understanding about wildlife. And the reason for that is really covered in this quote from Aronson, who wrote, "In an ambiguous situation, other people can induce conformity by providing us with information suggestive of what people generally do." This is a really clumsy, very sciencey way of saying if people have got no idea what to do, they look around and see what other people do. And in particular, they look around to see what people they trust are doing. Other people in the community, friends, family, parents, teachers, those sorts of things. Not always scientists, because scientists are evil and we work in basements in lab coats and are always up to no good. But are particularly other members of the community that they trust. So if you can get people to think well about wildlife and have good attitudes towards wildlife and good behaviours and good interactions towards them, then others will follow and they will copy those, even if they're not sure why they're doing it. So this is an incredibly important phrase, and in particular it links to changes in attitudes and behaviours. And attitudes and behaviours are not the same thing. Behaviour really is the doing thing, it's the interaction, it's the hands-on, it's the instantaneous event whereby someone might connect with an animal. And behaviour are drawn from a number of different categories. They're determined by our personality, our makeup. Some people are more timid, some people are really out there, get out and go. You know, some kids will go and grab a blue tongue at age 4, others won't touch them. Some people will handle spiders, others won't. So you've got genetic variation within any community, and you've got experiential variation, so that if you've had good experiences with blue tongues, you're more likely to be positive about them and do the right thing with them than if you hadn't. And behaviour is also influenced by a number of other things: personal capability, habit and routine, context, but in particular attitude. And attitude's the really interesting part of this story, because changing attitudes can be incredibly difficult. People develop an attitude, which is an evaluation of people, objects or ideas, and it's usually polar. So it's good or bad, it's pleasant or unpleasant, positive or negative. I've got a good friend who had a bad experience in Kangaroo Island, loathes Kangaroo Island now, will never go back. Never, ever, ever listen to a good word about Kangaroo Island. Developed a very bad attitude towards Kangaroo Island. Once they have been developed, can be incredibly difficult to dislodge that attitude and to change that attitude. There are ways, and occasionally it can be done very quickly, but often it is very difficult. And sexism and racism are two examples of attitudes that have been notoriously difficult to dislodge within communities. And that's because attitudes come from three sources in general: from belief systems, from feelings and emotions, and from actions, either personal actions or actions that they see other people doing. But even more important than that, attitudes come from knowledge and experience, particularly childhood experience. So in the case of the person who hated Kangaroo Island, his bad experience was as a child and could never lived it down, never got over it all. And much of attitudes are from this sort of experience. So there is a lot of work now to fit and connect people as kids with good experiences with wildlife in order to generate good attitudes towards wildlife and the environment. And then from those attitudes, the general feelings of positive approach to the environment, to then understand what to do, and that's which is the behaviours, which I'll come back to, and have good behaviours within. Okay, so that's the background for what we're trying to do here. Understand biology of animals, collect really good data, connect people with the environment, change attitudes and behaviours, and have a bit of fun while we're doing it. Well, to do all of that, we actually worked on 4 different animals over the last 4 years. We had to choose animals that were charismatic and common, because people had got to get excited about it. We found it was particularly good for those animals to have positives and negatives about them. We started off with blue-tongued lizards, but everybody loves blue-tongued lizards. Nobody's got a bad word to say about blue-tongued lizards, have they? Nobody does. But with possums, there's some downsides to possums. Magpies, swoops, spiders, it can be good and bad, those sorts of things. And we looked at animals that live with us and that are common with us in the city. Come on in, guys, yeah. And there are 3 types, really, of animals that share a space with us. Urban avoiders, those on the decline usually. They're native animals that don't do well around us. Urban exploiters are usually animals we brought with us, like sparrows or blackbirds or cockroaches. People aren't so much interested in them. But adapters are native animals that do well around us. And we particularly concentrated on adapters because people like native animals and they like to appreciate them and they like to know why are they in their garden. So we looked at those guys. And we did four studies. The first one in 2007 was blue tongues. Then we moved to possums, magpies, and finished up with spiders in 2010. And we asked specific questions about these. With blue tongues, we looked at distributions and interactions of blue tongues and our interactions with them in our backyards. In 2008, we looked at management of possums and people's environmental attitudes to them, especially the two different types, ringtails and brushies. We looked at what magpies were doing in our space and what people thought of them and whether interactions with magpies connected to how people used gardens and backyards. And then we looked at the distributions of different sorts of spiders and people's attitudes towards them in 2010. So we're asking very specific questions, and we got basically 2,000 responses in each of these surveys. Each one would have a different learning outcome, because that's the exciting thing from the general community. So for blue tongues, for example, range of habitats of various species and how to identify those I had not seen before was a typical response for what people learned about that study. Varieties, roof dwelling solutions and territoriality for Operation Possum. Roof dwelling, very important if you've got brush tails around. I learnt more about their family systems than I'd known before was a typical sort of learning from Operation Magpie. So, you see what we're trying to do here? How do we do it? Well, the first thing is we need to engage with thousands of people. You actually need to engage with tens of thousands or twenties of thousands of people in order to get 1,000 or 2,000 surveys undertaken. So to do that, we engage with traditional media, particularly 891 radio. And I'd been running a regular session with Matt and Dave there, which started in about 2002, just talking about urban wildlife. It was enormous fun. They didn't know anything about it, so I would bring in nasty, bitey things as often as I could to scare, especially Matt. He doesn't like those bitey things. But then from that, we started to do some field trips out with the community, and then we decided, well, we'll get Matt and Dave engaged in these operations. And the ABC have been terrific over many years engaging and promoting, providing space on the radio station, conducting the project as operations. They're all called everyone Operation Spider, Magpie, Blue Tongue, and so forth. We also engaged with Advertiser, and they were terrific. A little bit of television, but mainstream media to get people to be aware of the surveys. We also had a major website going that provided the resources. The two most important resources were the facts and fact sheets, which you could gain off the website, which was also connected to the ABC website, and also have people on radio to answer questions pretty much continually, or at least once a week. So either Phil or I did that, and we would do little fun facts for ABC as well. Did you know a magpie is doing this, blue tongue doing that, that sort of thing. So there was a direct connection with people and connection with the information around the question to be asked so that it would become easier. And these are the sorts of fact sheets that we made, and we got lots of input from museum and from a range of Department of Environment and Natural Resources, put together these fact sheets and distributed them widely for people to use, and they were a really good way to get the message across. The sorts of information we could gain, we gained so much information I could be here for 7 hours talking about it, but this is the sort of thing. So with Operation Blue Tongue, for example, people told us what the animals were doing in their backyard when they observed them. And we could put it together to get what's called an activity budget. So, and this is a pretty good one for lizards. They spend almost half their time hiding, a small proportion of their day eating, basking, mating, active. Dead isn't a standard activity for lizards, so we probably could have left that one out here. But not many errors in the data, and you could put together and then relate that to the where, when, and why from the rest of the data to get an activity budget of the animal. In this case, too, with blue tongues, we had six species. We had stumpies, eastern blue tongues, blotch blue tongues, pygmy blue tongues, and western blue tongues. And we could look at their distribution and then plot them. And in fact, there were four species found between the tips of the two peninsulas there and four down the southeast. So they're sort of hot spots for blue tongues. And we could look at their distribution through the Adelaide Hills. The black dots are stumpies, and the blue are the eastern blue tongue. And in fact, there are a lot lot more stumpies around than we had thought. We actually thought they were declining, but they were still relatively common throughout the region there. So we could get some good GIS data around what these animals were doing, and we could collect all sorts of other data as well. But we quickly realized that there was an issue here with working with ABC 891. And that is this the data of blue tongues, the six species of blue tongues in the state, or is this the data of ABC 891 listeners with blue tongues in the state? And if you have only one pin source, it's difficult to dissociate those two. And certainly 891 listeners, therefore, are a subset of the community. They tend to be over 40, very well educated, better time on their hands, and interested in their environment. So we have sort of artificially selected, if you like, a subset of the community to participate in the study. And that can influence, in particular, the attitudes and the behaviours type data here. So to get around this issue, we started with schools initially to develop an education program. And we kind of fell into it. We started with ABC, initially getting up some materials for schools, and we just posted out a CD to see if schools were interested in what we're up to. And we sent it to 30 schools in total. Five schools ran a unit of work from the information that we sent. 30 schools did a bit of information, used a bit of the information. Most didn't participate in Operation Blue Tongue. We kind of did it again with Operation Possum, and we got more school involvement. But with Magpie and Spider, we connected with the UniSA School of Education. Kathy Page and David Lloyd are here. And working with them, Phil developed with them a program where he worked with teachers before the survey started around the information, connected with schools and classes, provided the information in advance that linked in with school programs, particularly primary school programs, and it took off. And we wound up with progressively more and more schools involved. Magpies were great because every school has magpies in the oval and hanging around the garbage bins and so forth. Spiders were even better. Kids love spiders. Adults hate spiders. Kids love spiders. And we got a lot of really interesting feedback from teachers who, we had one teacher at an incredibly difficult class who commented that the only time that her children were not fighting with each other and killing each other and being really difficult was when they were out collecting spiders for Operation Spider. Kids loved it and they got really engaged in these programs. So it really took off and we were engaging a whole different part of the community through the school's program. And we also, with spiders, went to social media. And this was really new to us, being really old and very much a digital immigrant rather than a digital native. We decided we would open Facebook pages, provide information, have people to be able to download their own photos. We made a YouTube starring Phil and I. It's hideous, but if you want to go and look at it, about spiders. Kids loved it. And this was the sort of response we got from the Facebook page. We wound up getting basically a third of the respondents were kids under 17 and a much smaller proportion of the over 55s, which gave us a profile of age participants by the end of it, which is much more even across the community. So with Blue Tongue, dealing primarily with ABC, we got primarily people in the cohort 61 and over, or 41 to 60. By Spider, a lot of kids, teenagers, and then people represented more evenly. So the important lesson that we really got from this is to use as many different media outlets as you can and be aware that different aspects of the community use media and different sorts of media. But if you do that, you can then get a much broader cross-section of the community. So this was one set. The second set of data, so that was just some examples of the sort of hard information that we were able to collect with citizen science. The second bit we wanted to get was people and wildlife, how people reacted and interacted with wildlife in their backyards, and then how this related to their attitudes and their behaviours and what they did about them. And this worked really, really well for possums, for magpies and for spiders, because there's a paradox about urban wildlife. And people love them, and in fact the overwhelming number of respondents in all of our surveys loved the animals, but they also hated them too. And in fact this is part of our sense of place. And possums are a really good example. Everybody loves a possum, they are so cute. I mean there is nothing cuter than a possum. There is nothing worse than a possum in your roof at 3 o'clock in the morning peeing through the light. Well, actually, there's one thing worse. Two possums in your roof fighting and peeing through your lights at 3 o'clock in the morning. And we've all been there. We all know that experience. That's part of what makes us Adelaideans, is we have been woken up at night listening to possums hiss, fight and spray like there's no tomorrow. Yet we love them. So there's this paradox. And exploring this paradox is really important for understanding that relationship between attitudes and behaviours. Magpies as well. The stunning thing about magpies was the incredible attachment people have with them. And they're incredibly intelligent birds. They do amazing things. They do lots of interesting things. And people were really bonded to them. Although many of our respondents had been attacked by them, bombed, swooped, had their heads pecked, had their children pecked, their dogs pecked by them, either not very often, but sometimes quite frequently. Really only about half had never been bombed by a magpie. So again, we love magpies, we love hearing them sing, they've got the most melodious sound, but they can be a painful little nasty animal if they wanted to be. And this is another example of the possums. As I said, possums have their goods and bads. The respondents for possums actually showed that a significant proportion of people had major issues with possums. They either considered them to be a major issue, they spent a lot of time or money on managing possums, sealing their roof, keeping possums out of their apricot trees, those sorts of things. And yet, only 3% of people believe that the only good possum is a dead possum, and that 73% of people believe that we should learn to live with them, and a relatively smallish percentage consider them to be a nuisance. This was really important because when we took this to councils, councils get about 100, well, the Burnside Council, for example, got about 100 complaints a month about possums. So I thought, possums are hideous animals that should be exterminated. But what we're able to show is, in fact, 97% of a 2,000-strong survey loved possums. Nobody rings up the council to say, gee, I'm lucky I've got possums in my backyard. So they never hear the positive side of the story. They only ever hear the negative. And this is really important when you come to manage these possums in this urban environment. And in fact, people often got so attached to them that they treated them as pets. And they did this with magpies as well and give them names, you know, like Ringo, Rosie, Ruby, though there would be ringtails, Basil, Percy, Priscilla and Ping, Percy Possum, Ping Possum, Basil would be a brush tail, then there's some kind of weird ones, Arnie, obviously was a big possum, Matilda, Ray Charles, obviously had some vision issues, Mrs. Fat Bum, Fat Possum and the super large Jabba the Hutt. But they're people who are giving them, and once you give an animal a name, it's becoming part of your life. You are connecting with them, you're living with them, and they did it also very strongly with magpies. Both possums and magpies live a long time, and when they died, there was actually a grieving process that many people went through at losing these. And especially if people responding to the surveys lived alone or were lonely, their bond with a wild animal was incredibly powerful. And it's worthwhile, if you haven't had a look at some of the stories in the Operation Possum and Magpie books, about the grief that people went through when their backyard animal disappeared or died. So you've got this paradox, and this paradox really leads to this issue about attitudes and behaviours. And you can see the paradox because if you've got a good attitude, you should also then have a good behaviour. And in this situation, we were enjoying dinner. Oh, this is the paradox. Sorry, I've got ahead of myself again. The paradox of the possum, we were enjoying dinner at the house of friends when we heard a possum on the roof and urine started running down the living room wall. Our friends were furious and cursing and we all rushed outside, friends carrying brooms. Then we saw the possum with a baby on its back. Next minute, we were all outside with small pieces of apple trying to tempt it to eat. It was so cute. So that's really the encapsulation of the paradox of urban wildlife. It also applied to spiders too. And this was a real surprise to us because when we started Operation Spider, people either said, I love spiders or I hate spiders. Attitudes was highly polar, but it isn't. People actually differentiate between spiders. So when we actually ask them, I'm fearful of this spider, if we ask them about daddy long legs, hey, we're cool about daddy long legs. Nobody in Adelaide worries about a daddy long legs, so people weren't frightened of them. Not frightened is green. only 10-11% of people were frightened of daddy long legs. Huntsmen, still not a big thing, only about a third of the population were agreed that they were terrified of huntsmen. Once you got to the bitey ones, of course the percentage went up a great deal. So people were recognising different spiders, and they actually had different levels of fear depending on their knowledge of these animals. And this was transposed towards what they did with them. So in these graphs, there's a lot of colours here, but basically red and brown means kill it, green meant take it outside, and blue is leave where it is. So if you've got daddy long legs in your bathroom, most people left it alone. Probably most people here have got daddy long legs, have sat in the corner of the bathroom for years, and you just kind of leave it there without worrying about it. So people weren't frightened of it and kind of left it alone. When it came to huntsmen, kind of big and hairy, so many more people caught it, or they got someone else to catch it. This is invariably dad's job, is to catch the huntsman and take it out. And of course, there's the patent Adelaide how to get rid of a huntsman, a glass, put it over the top, slide a piece of paper out, take it outside. See that? You don't see that anywhere else in the world. And that's that classic sort of sense of place, the patent Adelaide huntsman removal technique. When it comes to whitetails and redtails, of course, people hit it with a rolled up newspaper or a shoe rather than moving them outside. So people responded differently because they recognised the different sorts of spiders and their fear wasn't the same. So there is a paradox there as well. Coming back to that point about attitudes and behaviours, you can have a good attitude towards wildlife and then you do the right thing that helps them and you and the wildlife live brilliantly in your space. You can have a bad attitude to wildlife, hate it, want to kill it, want to get rid of it, and that invariably comes to a bad set of behaviours that are actually bad for everyone. Or there's actually good attitudes but not necessarily good behaviours, which becomes a really interesting point that I want to follow up now. A good example of good possum management, we had possums in our roof. When we bought this house, they were urinating and defecating in the roof and fighting for territory and upsetting our dogs. We found out that if we could entice the possums out of the roof into the box, we could then close off the holes in the roof, keep them outside. In fact, this worked a charm. One possum in a box outside keeps other possums from coming into its territory. That's an excellent attitude. The people weren't happy with what the possums are doing in the roof, but they liked the possum, they wanted to do the right thing by them, they found the right bit of information, did the right management strategy, and everybody lived well. So that's where there is a really good attitude with a good behaviour came to a really good outcome. This one not so good. My eldest son blocked off the entrance to the roof at midnight a couple of nights ago, but unfortunately the possum was still in the roof. At about 1:30 this morning, there was a noise from our bathroom. Upon opening the bathroom door, a possum fell through the shower vent after it had pushed it out. As the other two members of the household were too terrified to open their bedroom doors, it was left up to me to rescue the animal. This I did by utilising a couple of crab nets. I don't know why crab nets, but crab nets. Throughout the ordeal, both of us remained relatively calm or both terrified of each other. So we've actually got a situation here where the guy's got a good attitude towards possums. He wanted to do the right thing. He didn't know what to do, and so he got crab nets. And a possum in a crab net is a really scary thought. Bad behaviours that led to a pretty terrifying ordeal for everyone concerned. So there you have a situation where a good attitude without the right sort of information can have a bad behavioural management issue. And then there's just the straight up bad ones. This is no favourite story, it's a horror story called The Possums. We have lived at our house for about 25 years. In that time, I've trapped more than 100 possums. I've given up counting. In one 18-month period, in the early to mid-1980s, I trapped 30 possums. I've caught two by the hand, one in the bathroom, and one outside on the trunk of a tree. Now, this guy's got a bad attitude towards possums. He wants them gone. What he's not getting is that there aren't 100 possums in his roof. Every time he takes one, another one comes in. So he's ground zero. He's the eye of the cyclone, sucking all of the possums out of the entire suburb as they come in there. But he thinks there's just hundreds of possums there. So he's got both a bad attitude and is delivering a bad outcome, particularly for possums. And this one, last night there were four of the outside to demolishing what's left of an apricot tree, another nearby digesting the apricot leaves, and another that I had only heard scrambling up a tree when I came out with a cricket bat. So he doesn't like possums. He's running around, probably in his underwear, swinging a cricket bat at trees. He's just an unhappy guy. There is no good end to this sort of story here. So you can have bad attitudes, bad management, and then a really unproductive kind of outcome. So what is really interesting, the goods and the bads you can leave out, the really interesting one is that connection between good attitudes and whether people are doing the right thing. Because if you can change that behaviour, if it's wrong, to being right, you can have an enormous impact both on people and wildlife and the quality of their interaction, and also the quality of the life for the wildlife in particular. And this is a good example of where attitudes don't always equal good behaviours. We asked the question of people who had blue tongues in their gardens, what they thought brought the blue tongues to the gardens. Okay, so why did the blue tongues come here? Most answered that they had planted native plants. Some said a water, then the other ones said bird feeders, no chemicals, nest boxes, veggie patches or other things. Now, in fact, it turns out that blue tongues really like pansies, daffodoodles, jonquils, introduced plants, high colour, large petals, and they love snails and slugs that come with the European plants. So in fact, putting in native plants doesn't actually attract blue tongues to the garden. Having an English cottage garden does. Also, having lots of backyard debris will make it heaven for a blue tongue. That's what they've got things to hide under. So a clean garden doesn't really help. Nest boxes are not used by blue tongues. Bird feeders also have no relation to blue tongues. But what they are is they're put there by people with a strong attitude, positive attitude towards wildlife. So people were creating a wildlife-friendly or a native garden, then seeing a native animal and equating the two. And in fact, the best way to bring in blue tongues is to put in lots of European high flowering plants and have lots of snails around. Water, of course, is a vital component. So we hadn't quite connected, or people hadn't connected, the biology of the animal with having that positive attitude towards having wildlife in their backyards. And we also saw this with magpies as well. Lots and lots of people feed magpies. I mean, it's a hugely popular occurrence here. In fact, we were really overwhelmed by the response of people to magpies. We had a saying really about Operation Magpie, which is everybody sees a magpie every day. And in fact, as people stopped and looked, it is impossible in Adelaide to spend a day without seeing a magpie. Because they are everywhere. And so people engage with them and they do interesting things. And they engage primarily by feeding them. And some people would feed magpies very frequently, daily or several times a week, and feed them inappropriate food, like bread, cereals, bird seeds, bacon's probably not too good for a magpie. So rather than better quality feed, a lot of cheese and mince was fed to magpies. Now, magpies can tolerate little bits of it. In fact, it's probably only about 2, 3, 4% of their diet is actually food given by people. And people gain so much from it, it's probably worthwhile actually having that as a continual connection with wildlife. But if you overdo it, of course, as often happens with seagulls at the beach, they can become obese from eating all those leftover chips and things. So this really enjoyable time spent with magpies can manifest as possibly feeding them the wrong things, which can be deleterious. So having a good attitude doesn't always lead to a good behaviour. So the final point we wanted to know was, could we change attitudes? If people hated wildlife, could we change it? And the answer is yes, a bit. You could. If you had the right questions and you got the right engagement, we found this with blue tongues. We got 4 or 5 people who responded to this question. Do you now like blue tongues? And they said they didn't like them, but now they do, even though most said no, they've always liked blue tongues. So we still generally sampled with people with good attitudes, but by engaging in a citizen science project, you can change their attitudes. Most people in Operation Blue Tongue had more questions that related to behaviour. They wanted more blue tongues in their space. They wanted to know how to do it and how to create a more blue tongue friendly environment. As you can see, some 1,000 respondents said this with, I'd love to know how to attract more lizards to my gardens. Most of those that didn't want to know any more information already had enough knowledge. And this increase in both people moving towards positive attitudes and having great behaviours is actually quite a high frequency across all of the surveys that we did. We haven't added spiders here, but as you can see, with questions such as observe more of the focal taxa, learnt new things about them, gained an increased interest in the animal, whether it be blue-tongued possum or magpie, and changed their behaviour towards them, these were in the orders of between 10 and 50%, really, or 10 and 40% of our respondents did it. This is the most interesting, I think. Learnt new things about them and gained an increased interest. And as I just said, magpies. Everybody sees a magpie every day, but almost half of our respondents, of our 2,000 respondents, by participating in the survey, got more interested in them and changed their behaviour towards them. So even something that's incredibly common, you can improve that connectedness with wildlife. Some examples of the behaviour change was things like putting down old pipes to become homes for blue tongues, possum boxes to keep, you want to keep a big bully possum around to keep the other possums away, and to avoid dependency which had developed previously, I avoid feeding magpies as often as I did. So people did change their behaviours through this whole process. So in conclusion then, you gain a lot from a citizen science project. We gained a lot about the biology of animals, we gained a lot about understanding people and wildlife, and we were able to influence attitudes and behaviours. Media is really important, and there's lots of different media to be able, and each media connects with a different set of communities. Asking the right questions is really important so that you can engage people. And why? Because we want to give people information about wildlife, we want to educate people. We need to understand what the silent majority are thinking, and that, as in that example with possums, and we still need to work on even more ways to increase the engagement of people who are not engaged. If you wish to find out more, Phil is supplementing his meagre pay with the books that we have here on these various projects. Actually, that's not true. All the money goes to the Barbara Hardy Institute. So have a look at them. They're on special outside there if you wish to pick up any of our books. Thank you very much, and I'll answer any questions.